Welcome to this session on React.js interview questions. Through this session, we will explore the most commonly posed interview questions that you would face if you walk up to a developer interview on React.js. Let's start with going through and exploring the general set of React.js interview questions that would be commonly asked in an interview. The first question would be, what are the features of React.js? Now, right through this session, we would follow a common methodology where we would explore the question and then look at the best way in which you could have answered that question if posed to you during a React.js interview. So starting with the first question, what are the features of React? So React has many extensions for complete application architecture support. JSX is used with React to describe what the user interface should typically look like. React is broken into small components. So you look at the complete application you want to build, break it down into individual components, and a component is typically a piece of user interface, like a function that would return a stream of HTML characters. Speedy performance is one of the core features of React, as only the updated components need to be re-rendered on the screen and not the entire page. The one-way data binding feature, on the other hand, keeps everything modular and fast. The virtual DOM is also a lightweight representation of the real DOM, which is again a feature which helps speed up performance and avoids a full page refresh and a full DOM tree shake, which really speeds up performance. So what is JSX? How do you answer this? So JSX is typically the extension used for React, and it's nothing but an extension to the JavaScript programming language, because all that you can use inside your browser for execution typically has to be JavaScript, because in HTML5 you cannot have any third-party plugins installed in the browser, and that's the reason the browser would only ship by default with a JavaScript runtime engine. So by using JSX, you can write HTML structures in the same file that would contain your JavaScript code as well, making the updates to the code very simple. So it's simple to update and make modifications to your code, because the code and the data and the business logic is all composed in a single file. So because the code and the business logic is in a single file, it makes updating and incorporating change requests to the code very simple and easy. So it's basically used with React to describe what your user interface should look like, and it's what you typically would term as the HTML template or the view. Coming to the next question, can JSX be directly read by the web browser? So web browsers cannot read JSX directly. Now, why is that? Well, the reason is simple. It's because they are only built to read regular JavaScript objects, and JSX is not a regular JavaScript object. It's a React component. So for a web browser to read a JSX file, the file needs to be transformed into a regular JavaScript object. And for this, there is a JavaScript API called Babel, which is internally used by React. So what do you understand by the virtual DOM that we've been speaking about in React? So React keeps a very lightweight representation of the real DOM, the actual DOM structure of the page. So DOM is Document Object Model. It is an API created by W3C, and it creates an in-memory representation of the HTML elements as a tree, inverted tree structure, a balanced tree structure, which is the fastest search algorithm when you want to search for HTML elements and do a dynamic update on them. But again, updating the basic DOM tree structure of the page causes a full page refresh, and if you only want to update a specific component, you wouldn't need the entire page to be refreshed, and that is where React comes in. It uses a virtual DOM, which is a layer on top of the actual DOM, which ensures that only a certain part of the page is refreshed, and that speeds up performance. So when the state of an object changes, virtual DOM changes only that object in the real DOM instead of updating all the objects, and this is what makes things really fast. So why use React instead of other frameworks like Angular? First of all, it's very easy to create dynamic web pages, HTML, where you can update the view or the template at runtime. The components are reusable, so you reuse rather than reinvent. The performance is great. Since you're working with the virtual DOM, you don't need a full page refresh. The unidirectional data flow makes data move one way. There's no two-way data binding by default, and that's the reason the page does not have to do a lot of heavy lifting of remembering whether the view is changing, whether the base JavaScript entity class is changing, and that saves a lot of processing time. Again, to debug React is much more simpler, and that's what makes it more popular in terms of its simplicity and speed as compared to other frameworks like Angular. What is the difference between ES5 and ES6 standard? So these are scripting standards, okay, that are defined by the European Computer Manufacturers Association, or ECMA, and all of the scripting languages are a subset of these standards and are derived from these standards to ensure that the code will execute on all browsers, and the code that we are writing is standards based. So these are a few instances where ES6 syntax has changed from ES5. If you look at the ES5 syntax on the top, we are creating a simple React class component, and the render function just returns a stream of HTML content. In EX6, there's a new keyword that comes in, which is extends. So you are extending from the base React component and creating a custom component and then returning a stream of characters. Also, the function keyword no longer needs to be used. So the exports versus export also changes. So you use exports to export out class from a module so that it can be accessed from another module. In ES6, you simply say export and the component. Require versus import. So you would require a third-party component or an API into your JavaScript file to use it. In ES6, it's replaced with the import statement, very similar to the syntax that we use in Core Java. So how do you go and create a React app? First, you install Node.js as a base platform, which you can download from the Node.js website. Next, any text editor of your choice, could be Atom, Visual Studio Code, or Sublime Text. Third, you create a React app using a command prompt terminal. Depending on the OS you are using, the command to give is create-react space my first app. Okay, so the command that you would give to create a new React app is create-react-app space and the name of the application you would want to create. In this case, it is my-first-app, and that could be a custom name of your choice. So what is an event in React? Well, on the web, when you talk about dynamic HTML, it's all about interacting with the user. So the user performs some interaction event with the web page, which could be a click of a button, a mouse move, and these events in action can be triggered by a user or any system, or could be pressing a key or a mouse click, etc. And in response to that event, you would execute a block of code, which is called an event handler. So here we have class simple, which is a custom class that extends the base React component, the name of the function work, which triggers a simple alert message box, and a render function which returns HTML. When you click on the button, we would want to bind that to the event handler this.work. And that's how you connect a click event to an event handler function. What are synthetic events in React? Well, a synthetic event is an object which acts as a cross-browser wrapper around the browser's native event. It combines the behavior of different browsers' native events into one API, which makes sure that the events are consistent across different browsers. And this brings in the standards-based development to ensure in this digital age, the code that we are creating for different browsers have consistency in terms of its execution. So here we see a function action link. We see a function handle click, which takes E as an event parameter. E.prevent default ensures that there is no error that the browser is raising in case the event function call is not directly compatible with that specific browser. So prevent default is used to suppress any browser specific errors or crashes. And a simple console.log, which will log into the developer tools window, which says you just clicked a link. And then we've got the return, where we are returning the view to, or the HTML template, where on click we connect to this event handler called handle click. So handle click is basically a wrapper, and the entire action link is a wrapper object, which is a synthetic event. We don't directly go and bind to the on click and then associate a function with it. We actually associate a synthetic object with it, which binds the base default event that could be specific to a browser. So some browsers would probably understand an onclick, some another browser would understand a click. And to ensure there is consistency of syntax, and from a development perspective, the code that we write will run on all browsers, we need to take care of using the synthetic events, which isolate the developer out from the complexity of writing code specific to different browsers. So you just write generic code which will work on different browsers. So how do lists work in React. So the lists display data in an ordered format. The traversal of lists is done using the map function. So here we see there is a function called list of names, which takes a variable props as a parameter. Props.names will allow us to get a reference to all of the array of names that are passed. Constant list names is another variable created equal to names.map. And we are using the arrow operator, which is now an ECMAScript standard. And again, we are using the opening tag of the li.html element. The key is equal to the name attribute. So the brace bracket will bind that to the name attribute. Then we just print the name itself and we close the li tag. So that's the names.map function. And finally, we return in an unordered list the list names themselves. So the map function will run through and iterate over the list of names, list them in the li tag. The li tag will get injected into the unordered list and will finally get returned out as a stream of HTML elements. In the next code snippet below, we create a constant variable names. We are associating it with a set of five names, and we simply say render list of names, names equal to names. The moment we do that, we are using list of names as a custom HTML element, which is not system defined. It starts looking for the function list of names, passes the names array to it, iterates over it using the map function, which is an inbuilt React function, brings out all of the lists. It's very similar to a for loop that you would write for iteration in other programming languages. And then finally, what you get returned in the get element by ID app is nothing but a list of simple names wrapped in a li element that are printed on the view. So why is there a need of using keys in lists? So keys are very important in the code snippet that we saw due to the following reasons. The first reason, the key is a unique identifier if you would want to search for a name in the list. It is used to identify which items have changed, updated, or deleted from the list. So if you want to perform CRUD operations on the data, you would want to search for which element do you want to update or delete or change. It also helps to determine which components need to be re-rendered instead of re-rendering all the components every time, and it increases performance as only the changed components have to be re-rendered and not all the components on the page. What are forms in React? So using forms, users can interact with the application and enter required information whenever needed. So forms can contain certain elements such as text fields, buttons, checkboxes, radio buttons, etc. And forms are also used for many different tasks such as user authentication, searching, filtering, etc. How do you create a form? Pretty simple. Again, create a custom component called nameFrom that will extend react.component. We create a state variable. This dot state is equal to value. We handle the change by writing a handle change event, and we handle the submit by writing a handle submit event. In the change event, we just change the state by saying set state of the value to event.target.value, event being a system defined keyword passed as a parameter. And in the submit, we simply alert that a certain name was entered and we trap the value that was entered into the form. Prevent default to suppress the browser from raising any errors. On the render function, we return a form. On the submit, we connect to the handle submit event and we bind the data submitted from the form to the handle submit event, and we pass the this pointer, which is a reference to the current context of the view itself. We open a label, specify the name, we then specify an input box as text. The value is set to this dot state dot value, and on change, we simply connect to the handle change event and bind to it and pass the context of the text box itself. So the moment we change the value in the text box as we are typing, the handle change event will receive the updated value and set the state. And when we click on the submit button, the handle submit event handler executes and we alert out the current value printed in the text box, and that's it. So how do you write comments in React? When you're a developer, if you want to comment out some code or if you want to set comments to enhance the maintainability of the code, a single line comment is as simple as given in most other programming languages, backslash asterisk to open, asterisk slash to close. Multi-line comments follow the same syntax and can span multiple lines to add comments to functions in terms of what the function can do and what are the types that it can return. What is the arrow function and how is it used? So an arrow function is a shorter way of writing a function in React. If you look at the snippet on the top, my input on change equal to, we are connecting to this dot handle change dot bind, and that's the longer version of how you can connect it to an event handler. The shorter version is on change equal to e arrow operator this dot handle on change. So you don't need to call the bind explicitly. You can replace that with the arrow operator and reduce the amount of code that you typically write. How is React different from React Native? So React and React Native are completely different. React was released in 2013. It's a web-based platform. It is HTML compliant. It generates HTML views. It uses CSS for styling, and it's based on JavaScript, HTML, and CSS. React Native, on the other hand, is targeted to mobility devices. It's meant to create installable apps on Android and iOS. Released in 2015, not based on HTML and CSS, and it basically requires the React.js API to create these installable apps for these mobility ecosystems. How is React different from Angular, another popular framework by Google? So Angular, created by Google, completely based on the model view controller pattern, works on the real DOM layer and requires a full tree shake at the DOM layer to update views and components. Supports bidirectional data binding. The rendering is purely done on the client side. The performance comparatively slow. React.js, on the other hand, created by Facebook, it's the view layer of the model view controller pattern. It works at the virtual DOM layer and is hence faster. It's unidirectional data binding and not two-way. And the rendering is typically what is done at the server side, and what you get as a response on the client is a stream of HTML characters as an output. Let's talk about and discuss some questions around React components. So what are components in React? So these are the building blocks. You can think of them as Lego blocks. So you break your problem down into small parts, each part identifying a certain solution of the problem, which is what we define as a component. So they are building blocks of a React application, and a single app usually consists of multiple components. So it splits the UI into independent reusable pieces that can be processed separately. A component is essentially a piece of the user interface or the HTML view. What is the use of render method in React? So it is compulsory for each component to have a render method. If not, there wouldn't be any HTML for the component to render on your view. So the render function returns the HTML, which is to be displayed within a component. Like you see on the screen, there is a class app that extends the React component, and it returns a simple H1 element called hello simply learn. And of course, do remember to export the app out so that it can be accessed from other components as well. If you need to render more than one element, all the elements must be inside a single parent tag like a div or a form. What is state in React? The state of a component is an object that holds some data within it. The data would influence the output of the component. Now, how do you implement state in React? So state holds the data that a component renders on the web application. For example, here we've created in the constructor this.state equal to, and this temporary anonymous object has two attributes, car and bike. When we return, we simply return this.state.car and this.state.bike. Now this is how you would create stateful components and access the state properties within the view. How do you update the state of a component? By using the built-in setState method, you can go ahead and update the state of the component. So here we have a simple render function that returns the state itself, state.message, and on the onClick connects to a button press function. The moment you click on the button press function sets the state to another message. So the initial message in the constructor is welcome to simply learn. The moment you click on the button, the setState triggers and changes it to best place to learn. So the data on the view would be updated. What are props in React? Well, props is just a short form for properties. And that is what allows us to pass arguments or data to a component. Props are passed to components in the way similar to that of attributes that are passed to an HTML element. So how do you pass props between two components? So let's say we have an app.js component on the top and a main.js component at the bottom. At the top, we are trying to return this.props.car and the bike. So two car and bike attributes associated with this props of the app component. In the main component, when you look at the render function, We are associating car prop equal to a value of 1600cc and bike prop equal to value of 150cc. And to access it, if you look at the import statement, we are importing app from app.jsx. And this is how you can cross-access properties from one component within the other. So what are the difference between state and props? Well, state holds information about the components. They are mutable. They can be changed. They cannot be accessed by child components, and they cannot have state. Props allow to pass data from one component to the other as an argument. They are immutable, they are read-only, and props can be accessed by the child component, and they can have props as well. What is a higher order component in React? So these act as a container for other components, which helps in keeping components simple and induces the reusability factor. They are generally used when a common logic has to be used by multiple components. That's when you group together a set of components within a higher order component in React. How can you embed two or more components into one? This code snippet demonstrates the app component, which returns a hello text, and it has a custom tag called simple. The simple tag is defined in the component below, and it returns text called simply learn. And in the render of the React DOM, we simply go and render the app component. So hello simply learn would be the final output, and that's how you can embed one component into the other using this methodology. What are the differences between class and functional components? So stateful components would extend React component in this case. And if you could look at the render, it simply renders this dot props dot title. The constant stateless component would be equal to props. The div tag returns this dot props dot title. So you can look at the style, very different in terms of class and functional components. One using the arrow operator, one using the traditional class and render method. So the class component can hold or manage state. Complex as compared to stateless components, can work all of the lifecycle methods of the component, and it can be reused. The functional component cannot hold or manage state. They are simple and easy to understand. It does not work with any lifecycle method, and it cannot be reused. Let's explain the lifecycle methods of components. We've got getInitialState, which is executed before the creation of the component. ComponentDidMount, which is executed when the component gets rendered and placed on the DOM. ShouldComponentUpdate, which is invoked when a component decides any changes to the DOM and returns true or false value based on certain conditions. ComponentDidUpdate, it is invoked immediately after the rendering takes place. ComponentWillUnmount, which is invoked immediately before a component is destroyed and unmounted permanently. Let's move to the React Redux set of questions. So what is Redux? It's an open source JavaScript library used to manage application state, and React uses Redux for building the user interface. What are components of Redux? The first is the store, which holds the state of the application. Store contains state, which defines the user interface, which triggers a set of actions, which are then sent to the reducer. So store holds the state, action is the source information for the store, and reducer specifies how the application state changes in response to actions sent to the store. What is Flux? Well, Flux is the application architecture that Facebook uses for building web applications. And it works in this way. The action is triggered, which is sent to the dispatcher. The dispatcher sends it to the store. The store sends it to the view, and the view sends it back to the action. And that's exactly how the steps would continue in sequence. So when we trigger an action, the dispatcher will get notified. Once the dispatcher has dealt with an action, the store's listening to it will get triggered. The view gets updated when the state of the store changes. User action at the view is sent to the dispatcher to then be processed. How is Redux different from Flux? Redux is an open source JavaScript library used to manage application state. The store state is immutable. It can only have a single store, and it uses the concept of reducer. Flux, on the other hand, is an architecture and not a framework or library. The store state is mutable. It can have multiple stores, and it uses the concept of dispatcher. Let's look at some React router questions. What is a React router? A React router is a package which is used to create routing in a React application. React router is used for developing single page web applications. It allows multiple views in a single application by defining multiple routes in that React application. How is React routing different from conventional routing? React routing has a single HTML page It uses, or the end user rather, would navigate multiple views within the same file called a single page app. The page does not refresh since it's a single page file, and there is improved performance since you're not navigating across multiple pages. Conventional routing, each view is a separate HTML file. The user would navigate multiple files for each view. The page would refresh every time the user navigates, which would hence result in slower performance. How do you implement React routing? You can implement React routing using a very simple method. Considering the above components, let's say you've got a component called app, about, and contact. So here you can specify the route path. If the route path is just slash the root default route, it takes you to the app component. If the route is slash about in the URL given by the end user, you automatically navigate and activate and load the about component. And if the URL is slash contact, it would take you to the contact component. Let's talk about React styling questions. How do you style React components? Either you use inline styling by using simple CSS, by simply saying color blue, and that's going to be the output of the H1 element. Or I could use a JavaScript object by specifying a constant simple style object and specifying a key pair value of color, background color, margin, font family, and apply that object as the style parameter, which would result in this styled output. How do you style React components using a CSS style sheet? So here's an external style sheet. So we've written all the styling rules in a separate CSS file, app.css. We've imported that at the top of the app.js React class, and lo and behold, you have the output simplified as generated on your page. Let's explain the use of CSS modules in React. So a CSS module file is created .module. .css is the extension. The CSS inside a module file is available only for the component that is importing it, so there are no naming conflicts. So .button is the CSS styling inside button.module.css, and that is what we've imported from in the app.js file. So when you view the button, styles.button is the styling picked up from the button.module.css file. Thank you for listening to us and giving us an opportunity of taking you through the most popular interview questions as part of a React.js interview that you would attend. If you liked our content, do subscribe, click on the bell button, and do motivate us, and we'll be more than happy to share a lot more content with you. Thank you for latching on to the Simply Learn channel.
Hi there. If you like this video, subscribe to the Simply Learn YouTube channel and click here to watch similar videos. To nerd up and get certified, click here.